morning, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us today. We welcome you all to our High Potential Week, which is an annual initiative taken up by People Matters along with Right Management. And this is the second year in a row running for this unique initiative. We thank you for all the overwhelming response to this unique initiative. People Matters, along with Right Management, collaboratively organized this special initiative called the HIPO Week, the High Potential Week, helping organizations to decipher the right way to identify and develop high potentials within their team. This is going to be a gateway for all of you to get answers to your questions in this arena. Within the week from the 12th till the 16th of May, we will bring to you a set of events including video launches, webinars, content-focused newsletters, tweet chats, radio programs, virtual coaching sessions, and a masterclass. You could also follow the hashtag HIPOWeek for updates, as well as visit the website www.peoplematters.in/hypo for more details. For today's session, which is going to be on Shopper Stop on their approach to hypos, we have with us Mr. Govind Srikande, MD, Shopper Stop India, who would talk about their approach to hypos, ways to identify, engage, and develop high potentials. He would share insights from Shopper Stop's initiatives for high potential development and the way forward in getting the future potential ready. Along with him, we also have Mr. Prashant Pandey, Vice President, Right Management India, who will add to the webinar through his insights and expertise on high potential development. He will contribute to the agendas of notifying, nurturing, and retaining HIPOs, along with learning right management gathered while working with Shopper Stop India. With that, I would like to hand it over to Tuhina Panda from Right Management.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Thank you, Puneet, for introducing Right Management and the HIPO Week. A little bit more about this special event. Puneet has shared that, you know, we're running this event second year on a row, and we're really, really excited to kind of bring it back to everyone for a second year. The event series is really special for us because the initiative, which was initiated by Right Management, is dedicated to the high potential leader development journey. And through this entire week, we hope to share with you different perspectives and stories of various stakeholders involved in the HIPO development program. You know, from clients, business leaders, coaches, high potential employees, and others. For today's session, we have, and sharing the story of Shopper Stop and the journey that they have taken in the development of the high potential employees at their organization. So, just to share a little bit in terms of the topic that we will be covering today, we would want to share with you the importance of high potential development for business leaders and the approach that Shopper Stop has used for its own employees. And what were the specific expectations from the high potential leader development process and journey that they had from different perspectives? Yes, Mr. Srikande will share his perspective, but also from the larger organization and a little bit about what the HIPOs went through. And obviously, he will definitely share a bit more in terms of the success story, the process, and the different activities that were taken up at Shopper Stop. To share a little bit about our facilitators for today, Mr. Srikande joins us from Mumbai. He has been with Shopper Stop since April 2001 and currently holds the position of managing director there. He started his association with Shopper Stop as vice president of buying and merchandising function, and has since grown within the organization, managing roles of COO and also taking charge as lead as CEO of the company. He has a rich experience from various industries in textiles, apparel, and retail. And before joining Shopper Stop, Mr. Srikande was associated with Muffet Lal and Johnson & Johnson. He was part of the team also that launched Arvind Denim and Arrow into the market. We also have today with us Mr. Prashant Pandey. He is Vice President with Right Management India and also serves as a regional practice leader for our career management practice in India. He has worked across various projects for Indian and multinational global clients across industries as banking, insurance, retail, manufacturing, FMCG and more. Prashant has also been involved in numerous assignments across the fields of assessments, leader development, and career management. He has over 17 years of experience in consulting and learning and development, and he has had the opportunity to work with leading corporate houses like Tata, Reliance, and Bharti. Today, we will be talking more about, the story of Shoppers Stop, but also a little bit in terms of the learnings of Right Management in working with Shoppers Stop, and obviously, and also share the point of view of leader development from the past engagements that we have worked on across India and outside. So, to share the agenda for today, Prashant will be starting off by sharing a little bit on Right Management POV and the observations and learnings from past engagements. And Mr. Shikhande will then take over to share the story and journey of Shoppers Stop, sharing his point of view and why it was important that they run this engagement at Shoppers Stop. He would also share a little bit on his personal journey and expectations from the hyper-development process. We will be open for questions and answers towards the last 15 minutes of the webinar. So request everyone to please hold till then, and if you have questions in between, please do share the questions on the Q&A tab given on the screen. So with this, I would like to pass it on to Prashant and to take over the presentation. Prashant, thank you.
I'm here. Thank you, Toina. And good morning, everybody. I thought it would be a good thing before, I know everybody is keen to hear about the journey of Shoppers Stop, and everybody is keen to hear from Mr. Shikhande about his experience in terms of developing high potentials internally. And I thought before we hand it over to Mr. Shikhande, it would be good to give you some background about our point of view around leader development. The reason why we thought this would make sense is because a lot of work that we have done, specifically in Shoppers Stop as well as a lot of other companies, is basically originating around this point of view that I'm going to share with you. And once that is on the table, I think a lot that Mr. Shrikant is going to share with you will then make that much more sense. So I thought it would be good to start off with that. So in the next few minutes, that's what I'm going to do. So this slide, basically, I would walk you through the slide from the left side to the right side, and this is a good one-page snapshot in terms of our point of view around leader development. Now, we all know that it's extremely important when we're getting into leader development to have it has to be based around the company's business strategy and growth plan. And we spend a lot of time in terms of understanding what the company's business strategy and growth plan is. This has to be, and when this is getting defined, and this is when this is getting interpreted by us, we really need to look at it in the context in terms of what is happening in the external environment as well as what is happening within the company, because these are factors which come together in any case to define the company's growth plan. Now, what do I mean by external factors? External factors typically would be in terms of what's happening in the regulatory environment, what's happening in the industry as a whole, how competition is behaving, the general health of the economy. These would be external factors. Internal factors would be things like in terms of what exactly are the systems and processes which are implemented in the organization. The current production capacity could be an internal factor that you would want to analyze. Now, these things come together, when you are looking at the business strategy and growth plan of the organization. Once that is understood and identified, basically in that context, the role of the leader gets very clearly defined. Look at the role of any leader in any industry, in any organization. You would realize that the leader has to basically play a role around three pillars. First is strategy, second is execution, and third is people. Now, typically, what are the strategy questions that a leader would need to answer? what new markets do I need to enter? How do I deal with competition? Do I outsource or do I manage processes internally? These would be the typical strategy-related questions that a leader may need to answer. Execution-related questions could be, how do I bring in efficiencies into the system? How do I reduce wastage? Process improvements? These could be the execution-related questions that may be in front of a leader. People-related questions could be in terms of, how do I create excitement in the entire organization around the vision of the organization? How do I manage conflicts within my team? How do I create a strong leadership pipeline within my organization? Now, these could be the various leader questions, you know, questions around people that a leader would need to answer. Now, it's extremely important to get a very clear map in terms of what exactly is the strategy role, execution role, and people role that this leader needs to play in context of my organization, business, and strategy. And interestingly, it would be very different. So, for example, two organizations on different maturity, you know, at different positions on the maturity curve, you know, would have very different. So, for example, a CEO of Shoppers Stop would have very different strategy execution and people questions to answer vis-a-vis, for example, if there is a new entrant in the retail sector today. The CEO of that organization's questions would be very different from the questions that Govind would have to answer, for example. Now, it's extremely important for us to get that understanding. And in that context, once that understanding is on the table, from a development point of view, we clearly need to define what exactly is the threshold level across these questions that the leader needs to be in for him to be successful. And this basically is the success profile that we are talking about. Before we get into any development, any assessment, it's very critical that we get this map right, because the assessment basically is against that ideal, is against that map that we create. And we spend a lot of time in terms of creating that success profile. The next step is basically about assessment, and once this map is rightly defined, and we spend a lot of time, as I said, and I'm saying that again at the cost of repetition, because if we don't have this map right, then the rest of the process doesn't fall into place. And we do have a lot of conversations with the business leaders to get that map right. And once that is done, then the assessment process happens. And I'll speak about the assessment process as we go ahead in the next slide, but the assessment process is basically mapping my leader and my leaders against this ideal map. Once this is done successfully, basically what we have on the table is the gaps. Certain strengths that the leader brings onto the table, and there would also be certain areas of development that the leader would have. Now that is very clearly put onto the table through this entire assessment process. Once this data is on the table, we get into the next step, which is the development stage, which is then talking about how do we leverage the strengths and how do we then address the areas of development. Now, this typically, again, I'll spend some time in a slide going forward in terms of what exactly is the point of view around that. We have a three point of view in terms of, you know, using a good mix of education, exposure, and experience as we go ahead. So we'll speak about that. One thing that we all instinctively agree is that any process needs to have a good, robust mechanism in terms of measuring the outcome. So, and a lot of us on the call would be HR professionals, and so many times we get asked this question, what is the ROI of this process? Now, that's a valid question. And from our point of view, we invest a lot of time, we have a lot of conversations with our client organizations, HR, and the business leaders in terms of how would we define ROI. Now, typically, there would be certain ROIs from a business point of view that gets defined, but we all know it's not always, you know, a one-to-one link that we may be able to establish in terms of leadership behavior to business outcomes. And in that case, it becomes extremely critical that we identify certain behavior changes that we are trying to bring into play, and we include that in the ROI map and then track those behavior changes. Now, that's something that we typically do in all our leader development assignments, and that is a map that we monitor and track continuously. one thing about leader development and specifically about HIPOT is that it can't be and it should not be a one-time, so it can't be a flavor of the day type of an intervention in the organization. And having certain mechanisms in terms of how do you sustain this entire process in the organization so that it's a continuous process becomes extremely critical. And when you're talking about sustenance, it's basically revisiting the success profile. You don't do it every year, you don't do it every 6 months, but what's the right time to revisit the leader's success profile and redefine it? It's different for different organizations, but what we are saying is to revisit that entire success profile and going through that entire process becomes extremely critical. And we have a lot of conversations with our client organizations in terms of what exactly are the sustenance mechanisms in the organization. Tuvina, can you get on to the next slide? Thanks. Okay. Now, I spoke about one of these steps about the entire process was was assessing. And this is a very critical because if you don't do this right, then probably you are shooting in the wrong direction in terms of investing resources, in terms of developing areas which may probably not necessarily be what either the business needs or may probably not be relevant in the individuals or the organization's context. Now, we have a point of view around in terms of when we are doing assessments, what exactly do you look at? And we speak about four P's. These are the four P's which are very critical when you are looking at an individual, and you need to look at this individual from a very holistic point of view, and there are certain data points that you would want to capture. The first data point that we talk about is performance data, and that's the first P. Performance, typically if you look at most organizations nowadays, have extremely, and that's something that we would like to believe, have fairly well-developed performance management systems in organizations. So typically what happens at the beginning of the year, the boss and the subordinate sits, there's a goal sheet which gets defined, you know, the KRAs, KPIs gets documented, both individuals sign it off, and then, you know, through the entire year, you know, 6 monthly, quarterly reviews, monthly reviews, and if you happen to be in sales, probably you get reviewed every on a daily basis. The point I'm trying to make is that at a given point of time, if you ask an individual what exactly his performance data is, the sense is that an individual would have a fairly good view of how he's performing currently. Similarly, the expectation is that the organization would also have a fairly good view at a given point of time what exactly is the performance data of this individual at a given point of time. Right. So, but that's an extremely critical data point, and if that's a question that we are not able to answer, then it's a challenge. But it's an extremely critical data point from a development point of view at a given point of time to capture what exactly is the performance of this individual at this point of time. The interesting thing about performance is that typically it's historical. Performance is about history, what has happened in the past. And while we all know that historical data may be a good predictor of future, but it's not necessarily always true. And hence, then you need to look into the second data point, which is potential. And potential is about what exactly is the potential of this individual for a role going forward. And this is something that that's the second data point that you would need to capture. Interestingly, performance data and potential data could be very different. So the point that I'm trying to make is good performance data is not necessarily essential that, you know, the potential data will be equally good, and vice versa is also not true. Now, typically, how do you capture potential data? From our point of view, a good old assessment development centers are a good way to capture potential data. The trick is basically in having good validated set of tools, having relevant assessors, and doing an assessment which is based on data, which is based on something that you can back basis observable behavior. And that's something that we are very particular about when we are doing a potential assessment. Third is perception data. Now, perception data, so many times, especially, you know, organizations and individuals specifically say, how does perception data really matter, because perception is perception, and so many times we'll say it doesn't really matter. And this is, but from our point of view, especially in the, if you're in the middle and senior level of the organization, it becomes a very critical data point for individuals to have and also the organization to have, because so many times perception data impacts your performance data. Right, and so for example, if I as an individual has a perception that I ask for reports, data unnecessarily, what may happen is that when I go out in the system and I ask for data from my peers, probably they'll push back, and what happens is that it may impact my performance. And hence, for a leader at a given point of time, it's extremely critical for him to get a sense in terms of what is the perception the environment has of me, because from a development point of view, it's an extremely important data point for the individual to capture. So, and our process strongly recommends that you definitely do capture the perception data point. The last data point that we speak about is personality, and personality is the core, is the way we are hardwired, is basically, and we all in our careers have come across people who, for example, would have struggled in sales. You take them out of sales and then you put them into a different role and probably they would have flourished. We may have come across so many examples in our careers. And basically, if you really look back, it's basically, and then you sit and wonder and ask the question, was he meant to be in sales to begin with? Right? So basically what I'm trying to say is personality. Who am I as an individual? What basically is something that I enjoy? What exactly is something that I would probably give me success? It becomes extremely critical for me to understand from a leader development point of view. And this is something that from an assessment point of view is something that we strongly recommend to organizations. So to sum up, basically what we are saying is our point of view is in an assessment process, performance data may probably be existing in the system. Most organizations do only potential assessment, and while we also do that, all we are saying is don't just restrict to that data point. Look into the perception data point also, look at the personality data point also, and then take a consolidated view of the individual in terms of who this person is on a, from a holistic point of view. Let's go to the next slide, Noina. Okay. Now, this slide basically talks about what exactly we have done in Shopper Stop and so in so many other organizations. At this point of time, it will give you a good sense in terms of why I spoke about our point of view to begin with. Now, in Shopper Stop, we have been working very closely with the organization for the past 2 years, more than 2 years in fact. And in the last 2 years, we have done a lot of leadership development work across hierarchies, across functions, and conservatively we have covered 60 plus leaders across various functions, buying and merchandising, IT, marketing, finance, HR, who have gone through this entire process. The process is basically to help them identify certain high potentials which are most likely to fill in a future role. And then, in fact, the organization, and I would let Mr. Srikande speak about that a bit more in detail, putting a finger on the right individual so that he goes on and fills that particular role. So basically, leader nomination. Step one was largely about leader nomination, and this is where Shopper Stop played a role in terms of using the performance data, the work experience, and they have their parameters fairly well defined. The leaders get identified. For example, when we were doing a process to identify area controllers for a certain in the organization. There was a filtration process by which around 10 unit heads were identified would go through the process. So there were certain parameters that the organization defined, and there were 10 people who were identified out of this process. The next step two, was the assessment process. Staying with this particular example, we typically use the three, this entire 4P process in this entire example, and there was a one-day assessment center, the 360 were administered. In this particular case, we administered Workman as a profiling tool, and then the basically three possible leaders were identified for the role of the area controller. Post that, all the three leaders were put in through a 6-month structured development intervention. This development intervention consisted of certain workshops. An individual coach was allocated to each of the leaders. And then we also used some very unique processes like study missions, where these leaders went to an organization in the aviation sector, specifically Indigo, to be specific, and basically understood in terms of what exactly they are doing to create a great customer experience, which was very true for Shoppers Stop also, and it was clearly a development area for the leaders in Shoppers Stop. Can we go to the next slide, Kuina? Okay. So this basically again speaks about the three P's that I spoke about. The performance data is existing within the system. Our focus basically is in terms of creating a process to capture the potential, personality, and perception data. Perception, typically 360 psychometric, we use a host of tools in Shoppers Stop. Specifically, we have largely used Berkman and Hogan. Potential typically would be a 1 or 2 days assessment process where a lot of case studies, role plays are used. So basically a storyboard is created around a fictitious organization, and then the individual is put as a character in this entire storyboard, and things are happening around us, and then we basically see how the individual basically reacts to the situations around happening around him, which gives us a good sense in terms of what his potential would be if this situation happens to him in future. Yeah. Tuina, next slide, please. Okay. I spoke about the development interventions. So we have a point of view around how. So when we speak to organizations, the first discussion that we have with organizations is that development is not necessarily training and only training. While we also do a lot of training and we have nothing against training, but basically when we are talking about development, it's about change of behaviors. And how much change of behaviors would happen in the four walls of the classroom is a good question to ask. Now, what happens beyond the classroom is something that we typically spend a lot of time discussing and put in a lot of processes around that. So while education, which is the typical classroom sessions, is something that we do, and we do a lot of that, but basically experience and exposure, these are the two things that we focus a lot around, because that's what we believe from a sustenance point of view around behavior change, probably play a larger role. Experience is about dirtying your hands, it's action learning projects, and we have extremely strong processes around designing action learning processes and implementing in organizations. We have done that in Shoppers Stop, we have done it in a host of organizations, and basically what our finding is that from a change of behaviors perspective, action learning projects probably are the best tool to use. And that's something that we use extensively. Exposure is basically getting exposed to leaders and who have done it and done it successfully in the past. So coaching, mentoring is something that we all understand as a process, but we also do something called study missions, where we take leaders from one organization and get them to spend a day or two in a completely different organization in a completely different industry. And this is largely around certain development needs that the leaders would have. For example, in case of Shoppers Stop, the development need was in terms of how do you leverage customer experience as a strategy driver. And we took the leaders to Indigo because that is something that they do exceedingly well, right? Let's come to the next slide. Okay. Now, this would be my last slide before I hand it over to Mr. Srikande to hear from him about his experiences and how's, what exactly his expectations are from HIPO processes. But these are certain learnings that we have had as an organization working for different organizations across industries, including Shoppers Stop. One thing that we have noticed and one thing that we firmly believe in, when we are talking about high potential development and leadership, leader development in general, you can't just leave the process to the HR of the organization. The HR definitely plays a key role, but the role of the business leaders becomes extremely critical. And we have seen organizations where business leaders get involved and play a critical role. We have seen processes giving better ROI in those organizations. Shoppers Stop being a case in point. Govind and his entire team, Mr. Shikhande and his entire team, the amount of time that they spend with us, giving us a download, sharing the expectations, helping us design, perfect the entire process, sharing, reviewing the entire process from a time-to-time basis, ensures that the process is on the dot. Now, this is a big learning for us, and whenever we go and speak to prospective organizations, our suggestion to them is, please get the business leaders involved. Don't keep them out of the loop. So that's number one. Number two is about communication, and something about communication that we have spoken about, we all intrinsically understand, but our experience is that so many times, probably organizations don't pay enough focus to it. Communication during the process is definitely key, but what exactly is the communication before the process gets kicked off to the participants, to all the stakeholders, is extremely critical. Post the process, when the results are being shared, when the output is being shared with individuals, specifically the people who have gone through the process, how do you communicate with them becomes an extremely critical element, because otherwise it leaves a lot of heartburn in a lot of people within the system, and that is something that you would definitely not want to happen. And hence, effective communication during all these stages is an extremely important point, and we spend a lot of time with our client organizations ensuring that this is taken care of well. Third is about the robustness and validity of the process. Any process is as good as the tools that we use in that process, and what exactly, how robust the process is, how validated the process is, and we are extremely critical, critical from that point of view, and we are very particular from that point of view. Spend a lot of time in terms of ensuring that the right tools are used. All the data is back, all our observations are back with data, and the report comes out is something that is defendable, and that's something that we spend a lot of time on. And hence, our experience is that leaders' openness to what we put up as recommendations is extremely high. Fourth point is clarity of career paths. One thing especially around high potentials is something that we all need to understand is that a high potential typically, and I could pass that as a statement, is that typically would be people who are extremely high on ambition, and they want to know what exactly at the end of the process is. What is it at the end of the process? Organizations should be very clear in terms of what exactly is a career path for individuals within my organization, because a process at the end of it, the vision for the individual has to be answered very clearly, what's in it for me? And hence, the clarity of the career path for individuals has to be very clearly identified, articulated, and communicated. Last and not the least, it can't be a one-time process. Once a hypo, always a hypo. That's not the paradigm. In fact, you need to look into the individuals, how they are responding to the process, and it's okay. And it's okay for an organization, and we have been in those situations before where we have seen, the individual is put into that process, and then we see the individual not responding well enough because it is demanding. It is demanding. It is over and above your day job, and you need to respond to it well. And if you feel an individual is not responding well enough, the organization should be okay to take a call otherwise. And so once a hypo, always a hypo is a paradigm that you can't work with. And it's not a one-time decision, basically. And these are some of our learnings, and this is something that we always communicate to our client organizations. Next slide, Suhina. Okay. I think now it's the time for me to hand it over to Mr. Shrikande, and before I hand it over to him, let me say, here is a business leader who has been involved, committed to this process right from day one. We have been engaging with Shoppers Stop for more than 2 years now, and every process he has been extremely hands-on. Being the MD of the organization, we know he is hard-pressed on time, but the amount of focus, energy, time that he invests on this is something that we really dream for as a service provider. So thanks, Mr. Shrikande, all yours.
Thanks, Prashant.
thanks for the kind words. I'm not sure whether I've been able to do real justice to everyone. But one prime thing I must say that we always believe that the biggest strategic element that we have in our organization is people. And I think to nurture people, to develop them is very, very important. So let's start straight away on the next slide. Pohira, if you can go on to the next slide, which is the Shoppers Stop overview. I don't want to read what is written here because you can read it at your leisure. Also on our site, if you visit, you'll find a lot of further details. But one big element of difference between what retail in India is versus what it is globally, the biggest difference is retail in India is an entrepreneur business. India is known as a country of dukandars with more than 13 million retail stores, and it is an industry that is dominated by the unorganized sector for a very, very long time. And if you look at the evolution of retail in India, it started off with the hot markets or the roadside markets, went into rationing shops. Then we have seen the journey of footwear stores, whether it's Bata, Corona and others, then into textile stores. And then post-90s, when Indian economy was liberalized, we actually saw the chain store concept coming into India. Post-2000, we also saw bigger formats coming into India. And post-2005, we also seen the biggest industrial houses of India entering retail in a big way. And in the last year, international competition coming in a big way. So we have seen various waves of retail change, and each of these changes have had an impact on retail per se and how we look at the business and how we look at various things. The other part is consumers have also changed over these many years. So while the industry changes and it's a reflection of the consumer changes have happened much faster, especially again in the last 15 years of time, post-liberalization, post-95. So if you look back and just look at some of the statistics, before 91, we had just one Doordarshan. Today we have more than 600 television channels. Till about 2000, the mobile density in India was very, very low. Today you have more than 900 million mobile connections. If you look at the kind of cars, the kind of bikes that we are driving, till 2005 and today, huge, huge amount of difference. So there is a lot of change that has happened. Working women have come into the population, which also means they are demanding different kinds of products. Kids now can actually decide what kind of rooms that they want, what kind of bikes that they want to play as far as toy cars are concerned. So each one of them has grown into a different lifestyle, and we are seeing the current generation, which is the youthful generation, spending more and more vis-a-vis generation of my time, which was more save and then spend. And then if I look at my parents, they were more save and save and save. So these are the differences that are also getting reflected in the consumer market. Moving on, how do we look at the pipeline of the talent? So as I mentioned, the competition is changing, purchasing power is changing, new dot-com practices also come in, and we are seeing that in the last 24 months time with entry of various players. So when you look at how we look at the success of the business, right from people management, stock management, financial management and debt management, these are the levers that we use. Can we move to the next slide? So while we grew, in the first 10 years, we are only 7 stores from 91 to 2000. From 2000 to 2005, we actually hit 19 stores. And from 2005 to 2010, we actually achieved 38 stores. In the last 3 years, we have doubled the number of stores to 67. So while this growth has happened, we also entered newer cities. We also entered new segments of the market. We also started newer formats as well. And as we grew up, as we scaled up, newer kind of requirements came in, whether it is store planning, merchandising, analytics, or marketing, or direct marketing, or now we are talking of social media marketing. Each one of these roles have evolved over the years. But the biggest challenge for us has been that retail has never been considered to be a very, very top-of-the-notch career path. Because many people who joined us in the initial phase said that, is retail the right course for me? Because in retail, you have to work Saturdays, you have to work Sundays, you have to work on public holidays as well. And that's why you're always at the forefront in terms of action. So while you learn a lot from the customers, because you're in touch with them directly, this is very, very hard work. You have to stand in the store for 8 hours, you have to keep on smiling at customers, even though merchandise is available or not available. And even at the back end, you have to continuously work and rework on merchandise availability, replenishment, and ensure that margins are met, deliveries are met, and you are able to meet your sales target. So it's one of the tough industries in that sense, and a lot of people who joined us earlier said, who's going to marry me if I am a retailer? If I'm called a dukandar, will my prospects of getting married get impacted at all or not? So it has had its own challenge of entering the retail industry, and that's the reason we have seen that we have had to really develop from day one a strong line of pipeline of people at various levels and various roles, and that's what we have been doing for the last, I would say, more than 18 years or so out of our 23 years journey.
Next slide.
So I talked about this part of our systematic approach in scaling up. We have actually initiated three big areas of change, and those three big areas, one of them is called Baby Kangaroo program, as you see it. A baby kangaroo, as its name suggests, that when you look at a kangaroo, there's a kangaroo and there's a joey. And what joey learns in the sack of the kangaroo is how to really deal with life, how to deal with difficulties, and that's what we do in a baby kangaroo program, where a new assessed candidate is assigned to a mentor, and the mentor guides the new assessee in the ways and means of developing into a manager. So the new joinee who joined us as a CC at the front end has no reportees. After a year, appears for a baby kangaroo development assessment center program, clears it, and then gets a mentor attached to him. And the mentor ensures that he learns the ways of managing people, understanding his role, and ensuring that his growth path is really clearly established. So Baby Kangaroo program has been running well for us, again, for more than 15 years, and we've seen a lot of baby kangaroos grow up and have become storeheads for us in the last 10 years' time. Second has been the development and assessment center for almost all the positions other than the front end, where the Baby Kangaroo program is taken. So whether it's buying merchandising or finance or area controller, all these people have gone through development and assessment center. Initially, when we started off, we were only doing assessment centers. And one of the feedbacks that we realized was that if you actually undertake only assessment centers, you are actually doing injustice to the people, because they actually are not being given any tools to really develop their competencies. And as things happen, as things change, you require different competencies at different levels. And the biggest challenge definitely is, which is the right competency for which role? Is your current role right for you to really be assessed for the new role? Is your current competency good enough for the new role? And that's where the development center is very important. The development center identifies what are the current competencies, what are the right competencies for the new role, and it then gives inputs to you as an individual to develop those competencies over a period of time. And then you are assessed whether you have been able to adopt to the new competencies, have you been able to scale up your knowledge base and really take it up. Now, some of you might think that what is this development assessment center? So basically, to just give you a base example, when you look at cricket as a game, cricket evolved for so many years as only a 5-day test match. From a 5-day test match, over the last 30 years, it went into 50-50, and over the last 4 years, has gone into T20. Now, if you look at the kind of competency required to be a test player versus a 50-50 versus a T20, each one of them is different. And yes, some players have adopted well, whether it is AB de Villiers or you can say Virat Kohli, but not all players have been able to adopt to the T20 game the way they adopted to a test match. And that is where competency requirements change as the games on the ground change, or as consumers change, or as the industry changes, you need to really acquire newer competencies. And that is where the requirement of newer competencies comes in, and that's where Development Assessment Center makes a big, big impact. Third area that we always use is, we have not benchmarked ourselves only to the retail industry in India, because there are very few retail professionally managed companies within India, because we are one of the rare companies in India which has never been managed by a promoter. They always looked at it as investors. So professionals who have been on from day one in the company have had to not only look at business, but I also looked at the longevity of the company and development of the talent strategically all the time. So we always looked at global benchmarks and other verticals across the industry, whether it's Indigo or Domino's or others, where we have looked at benchmarking practices and have looked at ways and means of adopting some of the best practices that could be applied to our industry. Can we go to the next slide? So what is it that is important in any of the development assessment centers? A lot of times, you know, we have very lofty image about how do we run a development assessment center, but at the same time, how do we really operate it? And Prashant touched upon some of the topics there, including communication. So my take on the entire development assessment center, one of them is design of the program and the tools used. Now, how many days of development center do you use? Is it a 5-day development center? Is it a 6-month development center? Or is it a 9-month development assessment center? So depending on the role, depending on the size of the role and leadership of the role, you must decide how much time frame you want to give to any development center and then complete it over that time frame with the right kind of tools that are utilized, whether it is case studies, interview program, or what is the kind of training that you have even with the assessors, because the assessors also must be well equipped with their understanding of the business and understanding of the retail or the individual's capabilities to really make the right judgment in terms of how the individual is performing. Second is definitely the execution of the program. And in the execution, when I look at it, creating the right design, ensuring that you clearly create job descriptions for each role, you have clear assessments for new roles that are going to emerge or the kind of new positions that are going to emerge, and then go back and relook at the design of the assessment development center, because as competencies, newer competencies are required, you need to really adopt those competencies also as part of the development assessment center. So this is again an evolving piece. You have to continuously revisit the program, and over the years we have used various models within it and have been fine-tuning it every year. Communication, communication, communication. It is, I think, very, very important, whether it is pre, during, or post. And especially I would say post, because many times you clearly know that during a development assessment center, if 10 people are appearing, there is the only possibility, like any test match or a one-day match, is there's only one winner. And at the end of the day, if only one person is going to clear out of 10, there are 9 people who are not going to clear. And those 9 people need to be handled well. If there are new positions that are going to come up for them in the future, how do you really train them? How do you develop them for those positions? If they cannot be absorbed into a new position but need to be reassigned to an existing level position, how do you really ensure that their motivation level remains same, and how do you take them to the future? So I have seen a number of cases of good performers in the organizations who have failed to clear a development assessment center. Luckily for us, we also ensure that sometimes we have been able to retain the position without filling in by a new incumbent when an existing guy hasn't cleared. So over the years, if the person is able to develop himself better, he is able to reapply and get into a reassessment and clear set, he can still get into the position. So we have done that in the past, and we have seen, at least personally I have seen, at least 3 or 4 cases who have moved up from a merchandiser level to a trading manager, having not been able to clear the assessment center in first instance, but have been able to clear it over 2 or 3 instances. So luckily, I would say, we have had some good talent who was able to understand our philosophy, and we have been able to take them through the curve. But this is, I think, the toughest of the challenge of not only communicating clarity right at the beginning of the development assessment center, during the assessment center, and post-assessment center about the right results, about the right communication, about the right future of the individual. Because at the end of the day, everyone is looking at one path of growth all the time. And if you are not able to give them the growth path, then definitely they have the option to look outside. And that's something the organization must clearly understand, that we are here to provide opportunities. Some opportunities may be the right ones for the right candidate. Some may not be there for the right candidate at all. And that's where the choice comes in. Last but not the least, sincerity of the top management to back the outcome. And many times it happens that you might get surprised with the result that is coming out, but then you cannot make choices. You cannot play favorites in terms of what is right or what is wrong. You have to accept the result and work on it and then start executing it with the right attitude and with the right honesty in terms of how the results are fair. Yeah? We can go to the next slide. So that's in the walk the talk. Success stories, lots of them. So as I mentioned, I joined this company as buying merchandising head and moved up to COO position, then CEO position, and then president and the managing director. On my way, I have gone through 2 development and assessment centers. I've gone through 1 360 degrees and have been given lots and lots of help in terms of interventions, international store visits, international mentoring, international workshop participation, various kinds of interventions have been given to me, and that definitely has helped me. When I joined Shoppers Stop, I didn't have too much knowledge in terms of details of retail. Although I have managed retail on the back end, I had good knowledge on product, I had good knowledge on HR, but really speaking, I didn't have much of IT and loyalty knowledge of retail when I joined. But over the years, I've been given all the support to really learn, understand and grow. And I would say even now, still lot of things yet to learn, especially on the e-com side, if you ask me. But this is a continuous learning organization, and as an individual, I would always say that one has to keep on learning all the time. So the personal journey has been very satisfactory, and I have seen that the organization has always supported me in terms of taking to the next level. If you look at other examples, we are known across the retail industry to be University of Retail, and if you look across various other retail companies, including our competition, some of the CEOs of these organizations have come from Shoppers Stop. Within the organization, we have seen lots of customer care associates who joined us at the lowest level are today store heads and area controllers. Two of my department managers, which is the first level of management within the Shoppers Stop chain of actionables, one of them is now CEO, which is Salil Nair, who joined us as department manager in Mumbai, went on to become a store head in Hyderabad, then to Bangalore, came back as buying merchandising head for only menswear, then became for non-apparel, and then over the years he has graduated, and this year he is taking over as CEO. Mr. C.K. Nair, who also joined us as department manager, over the years again has been very successful and is today the CEO of Homestock. Gopal Asthana, who joined us as a management trainee, started in the projects department and has moved on from that place, and today he is heading the buying merchandising of the company. So lots and lots of examples within the organization where people have succeeded over the years and have gone into the top role within their vertical. When we talk of ROI, I think as I mentioned earlier, lots and lots of retail CEOs have come out of Shoppers Stop. When I look at all top positions, majority of them have been filled internally, and that itself is a matter of pride as well as I would say return of it on investment as well. And we also, as I mentioned earlier, held roles for individuals if they are not competent at that point of time, and allowed them to grow over a 2-year, 3-year period to move into that particular position. So I would say definitely this Development Assessment Center program, the training and development program that we have been running over the last 15 years plus, has definitely delivered to us. Yeah, next slide. So thanks for the patient listening, and I welcome any questions that you would have on this entire process that we explained right now.
So,
thank you, Mr. Shrikhande. Yes, Prashant, I'm here. So do have a couple of questions which have come in, and I'd request either you or Mr. Shrikhande to please take them. So the first question is, how to involve business leaders in the process of leadership development?
I think the biggest stakeholder in an individual's development is a business leader. So if you want to deliver performance of the better level or the higher level in your own vertical, whether you are in IT, whether you are in buying merchandising, or whether you are in operations, typically one has always looked at the fact that your successor should be better than you. And if your successor is better than you, you can definitely deliver better numbers, better achievements for the future. And that's why it's important for you to identify that individual, support him in his growth, support him in acquiring your competencies, and that really means that your deliverable can be far, far better. So I think when you're convinced as an individual, when you're convinced as a leader, that development of your team is very crucial for the business growth, I think you become part and parcel of the growth plan and support it fully. Yeah.
Okay. So the next question is, how important is it to define a career path for developing talent?
I think this is a tricky one because there are two challenges here. One of the challenges that we have seen is we always believe that individuals' career choices are dependent on how they look at their own growth. And typically, an individual looks at a much faster growth than a company would look at, because company's growth plan is always much longer depending on its business plan and the needs of the business, whereas an individual would like to jump every 2 years and 3 years into a newer position or a newer designation. So there is a mismatch of speed definitely between an individual's career path and the way an organization is looking at the career path. But there is a meeting point for sure if the organization is able to meet up and understand and frame up for the individual what are your competencies, what are your competencies requirement for the future, and am I being able to take care of those competencies and develop them over the years, then there is a meeting ground for both. And yes, then the individual is willing to accept a slightly slower growth in his career path vis-a-vis what he can get outside. Because typically if you look at any of these individuals who have grown in the organization, it is quite possible that they have spent 17, 18 years in the organization to meet up to this growth. It is quite possible that they could have achieved the same amount of growth maybe in 13 years or 14 years if they had moved outside. Because outsiders always look at some growth plan for an individual much better than an insider. But at the same time, one has to also look at what is the organizational culture, what is the organizational framework and infrastructure to support you to grow, to improve your capabilities and competencies, and a foolproof mechanism for you not to fail in the new role. Because when you move outside, there are equal chances of you succeeding or failing, because you are going basically based on a role or a responsibility without really knowing what's going to happen as infrastructure in the organization or support system in the organization, which today definitely you know when you are inside the organization.
Also, just to add to what Mr. Shrikhandri said, see, please understand that the process needs to have a purpose. And when the individual is investing his time, energy, you know, you need to convey a purpose. Now, that purpose so many times in organizational context becomes a career path. And, you know, so to have at the end of it, at the end of this tunnel, at the end of the journey, what? Now, if you want commitment from individuals, you know, the what's in it for me needs to be answered for those individuals. And in that context, it becomes an important conversation to have, an important question to answer. How soon, how fast it will happen, you know, is again a matter of conversation, as Mr. Shrikhandri said. Yes, I mean, and especially high potentials, extremely high on ambition, extremely impatient in terms of things happening to them, and they want things to happen to them really fast, which may not necessarily be possible in the current organizational context. So those are expectations which need to be matched. But yeah, at the end of it, you know, you need to answer the question, what this purpose, what's the purpose at the end of it, you know, and the what's in it for me needs to be answered for those individuals.
Thank you, Mr. Shrikhandri, and thank you, Prashant. We have one more question. This is, as we are in the process of developing leaders through hyper-identification and development, once we achieve that, how is developing leaders going to happen in case a business does not demand for a leadership position? And how do we occupy the, you know, the individual, the high potential, till that time the position is defined? And in addition to that, what if the individual, suppose there is a role and, you know, the individual themselves are not ready to take up that opportunity and that role? How do you engage them in that process?
Yeah, so you're asking me two questions. Is the position ready and is the candidate ready?
Yes,
right?
Yes.
So both have a similar kind of a treatment fundamentally, because if the position is not ready, so for example, when we looked at a growth plan, so we identified earlier that from moving on to a 17 store to 50 stores, we knew that operationally we required more area controllers, we required area accountants, we required area PM. Because administratively, one individual couldn't get reported to by 50 people. So those were the positions that we planned. But what really happened in 1 year was, while we had planned for opening of about 8 stores, in reality we opened only 2 stores. So we had identified the role, the individual was identified, but the role wasn't there. Because the two area controllers, that roles that we had created, they had got delayed. So in the interim, we talked to them, they were clearly aware that we had not opened so many stores, gave them the option of working in another retail store so that they could get exposure. Number two, we also gave them exposure at the head office in other functional areas, which is like buying, merchandising and marketing, to make their experience more rounded, and at the same time prepare themselves, because the job was definitely going to come, it was only getting delayed. And the job came up after about 14 months or so, and by that time they were a little more rounded than what they were earlier, and they did get that position ultimately. Same treatment also when an individual believes that yes, he doesn't have the capabilities or competencies. Again, you go back and relook at the result, in the result what has happened and what has he achieved or not achieved, and then start working again on the same modules by giving him the exposure, asking to work on projects or do another workshop kind of simulation, and also give him cross-functional experiences, again which can broaden his outlook for the company as well as the market and the retail industry per se. So that's what we have done in the past wherever we have gone into these kind of situations, and even in future I would say similar kind of situations can happen.
See, in such cases transparent communication is key, and the second case where you are saying, in case you are talking about a scenario where the individual has been invested upon and there's a position which he's been offered and he's reluctant to take it on, now that's a tricky one to be honest. And you know, and how much would you want to get into a situation where you're selling an internal job to a candidate? Now that's a big question. And because if you oversell it, and then you know, if you force the individual, how optimally he delivers in that situation is a big question to ask. But then, can you afford, you know, to be in a situation where the organization wants the individual to play a role and he's not, you know, willing to take that role on? So it's a tricky one from that point of view, and you know, at some point of time you may need to take a call. So that's the way I would look at it. So this balancing of, you know, overselling, you know, why you would want the individual to take that role on, and when do you take a call is a tricky one. And that's the balancing that you may need to do.
Thank you, Prashant. Thank you, Mr. Shikhani. So one last question that has come through. If you can share a little bit in terms of the entire communication plan around the high potential development process at Shopper Stop, and a little bit specifically also about, you know, the post assessment center communication that was done.
Okay, so I think one of the things that we have been practicing over the years is, even before a formal announcement of a development center, assessment center is made, we always talk informally to all the individuals who are going to be part of the development assessment center. So you start off building up or warming them up for the coming up of development assessment center. One of the key challenges for a development assessment center is, every individual comes back and says that, look, I have performed for the last 3 years, why do I have to go through a development assessment center? So there is an inbuilt negativism built around the development assessment center. Are you making me go through some kind of rounds because you don't think I'm ready, or you want to make a choice? These are obviously built-in defenses by every individual. So you need to warm up the individual to actually face the development assessment center. So that's part one. Number two is, when you do the formal development assessment center communication, again, it is not really sent out in a written form. You actually call them into a meeting room and communicate to all the candidates together, ensuring that there is balance of communication. Everyone needs to know that each one of them has an equal chance of making it. You must also communicate during that period what is likely to happen in case one candidate makes it and others don't make it, what is going to be the post development assessment center action plan as well. Then you get into the development assessment center reality, in which the development center, you actually conduct the competencies are assessed, post the competencies are assessed, then you go back and say, okay, these are your competencies, this is what the role requires, and this is what we have to make in the next few months' time. If it is a 2 month of development program or 1 month of development program, these are the interventions that we are going to provide, this is the mentor that we are going to provide, these are the tools that we are going to provide or exposures that we are going to provide, and you keep your own diary. So many of them have actually a diary of tracking things around as to where they are progressing, how they are progressing, and over the development period then they are continuously tracked as to what is the intervention and is it being achieved or not. Then when it comes to the final assessment center, obviously it is the final result, and again you build them for the result. And again, the same challenge comes through that a lot of people think that it's a one-day match game. So if I don't perform on that day, do I fail? So recently, we also adopted this practice of attaching a 20 to 25% weightage to the last year's performance track, which actually balances off. In case there is any challenge on that particular day, you actually can bring in the 25% weightage for job performance over the last 3 years' time. And that is actually coming in again transparently, that your performance rating of the last 3 years is averaged out and taken. So again, it is not a number that is taken out of anybody's mind, but you are actually taking the weightage of an actual number that the individual knows and the assessor knows very well. Last but not the least is post the assessment center, as I mentioned, a number of people are not going to clear it. So what do you do with them? How do you deal with their issues? And how do you deal with their future challenges? Because, for example, there are no multiple CEO roles in any company. There's only one CEO role. And after a development assessment center, if only one candidate is clearing it, the others have actually not made it. So is there any plan for them? Is there any plan for them to really grow their job role? Is there any multiple things that you can add to them for the future if they have not made the cut for the CEO, but are they in a position to really take on additional responsibilities? So can you groom them for those roles? That's the call. And that's where you start working on as to what can be added on value to their individual role so that they can continue in the organization, clearly knowing that they are not cut out for the current role, but they can really enhance their own role better in the future through the development assessment center that they've gone through and deliver better for the organization. So this is a tough one in sense of right at the beginning, you know that some are going to fall out. So a development assessment center, when you are going on the journey, you actually know that some candidates are going to fall out. So you have to be really prepared for that from day one and really be prepared to be a human focused so that the individual doesn't believe, individual has to believe finally that it is a very transparent process, it has been handled well, handled humanly, and all my issues, etc., have been taken care of. At the end of the day, the result is a result.
Just to add, when you are planning communication, there are a few questions that you may want to think and around the what, why, and how, and who rather. Who communicates, why the communication is important, and what do you specifically communicate. And for each phase, the pre, during, and post, the questions, the answers could be different. To give you an example, who communicates, definitely from our point of view, it has to be both the business leaders, the you know the managers, need, the immediate supervisors need to play a role in terms of communications, and of course HR in any case would do a lot of communication. Why basically would be around, you know, you as Mr. Shrikante mentioned, human defense mechanisms comes into play and there will be a lot of questions that people may have. And the why is basically to address all those apprehensions. Create excitement, give them assurance, it's a process which has been thought through, it's fair, validated, you know, and those are the whys basically through the communication that you would need to have. The what is basically in terms of what mechanisms do you use and you know, and you'll need to think through from that point of view. But basically it's the what, why, and who communicates.
Thank you, Mr. Shigan. Thank you, Prashant. With this, we come to the end of our webinar today. And it has been indeed a pleasure to have Mr. Shrikante here with us and to share his perspective on the entire experience at Shoppers Stop. And thank you, Prashant, as well, for sharing your inputs and you know, the experience of working with Shoppers Stop and how it has you know, added to our expertise as well. Thank you, everyone, for your questions, and we look forward to your continued participation throughout the entire week. We have a bunch of events following today that we will be, you know, reaching out to you through. And do join us. I hope you have received the registration details for all the events. Today afternoon, we have another coaching session with one of our executive coaches. Indeed, it has been a pleasure. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Puneet.
Thank you, Tuina. With this, we're going to wrap up today's webinar, the first in a series for this HYPO week. We would like to thank our partner, Right Management. Our special thanks to Mr. Shrikante for taking out time from his schedule and also sharing with us his experiences and insights. Special thanks to the webinar audience who joined us today. Please do join us today at 2 p.m. again for the first virtual coaching session on HIPO's organizations and their challenges. Keep following us at hashtag HIPO Week for updates, as well as visit the website peoplematters.in/HIPO for complete details and schedule on this initiative for this year. That concludes today's webcast. Thank you all and have a great day ahead.
Thanks.